21ª Cátedra Europa, el encuentro académico y cultural del Caribe colombiano y el mundo académico europeo. Europa se vive en el Caribe.
The answer, the question was mathematics only for nerds and dreamers. And the question I would like to try to explain to you is that it's not exclusively for nerds and dreamers. So let me start by showing you some quotations of famous people about mathematics. So Galileo said, mathematics is the language with which God wrote the universe. Okay. Carl Friedrich Gauss, well, a famous German mathematician from the 19th century, was saying mathematics is the queen of science. Hilbert is also a famous mathematician from beginning of 20th century. And he was talking about a student with this quotation. He's saying, okay, you know, for a mathematician, the student did not enough have not enough imagination, but he has become a poet and now he's fine. So that's expressing already that mathematics has something to do with being a poet. And I will try to explain at least a bit why this is so. And then the last quotation is by Charles Darwin. A mathematician is a blind man in a dark room looking for a black cat, which isn't there. Okay, obviously Darwin was not a friend of mathematics. But and sometimes he is also correct that mathematicians are looking for things that are not there. But sometimes a mathematician will find the black cat in the dark room. And then everybody's happy. And also, it's interesting that there have been Hollywood movies about mathematicians. So you might know the movie A Beautiful Mind, that is about the mathematician John Nash, who invented many, I mean, he did some mathematics related to game theory and also analysis and with applications to economy in the end. Then there was the movie The Imitation Game, which was about Alan Turing. He was maybe not strictly speaking a mathematician. He was like also a computer scientist and went into this direction. And then there is the movie The Theory of Everything, that was about Stephen Hawking. So this is also a bit cheating because he is a theoretical physicist. Ah, excellent. Excellent, thank you. So let's try it. This does not point. Okay, point. Hawking was a theoretical physicist, but as I will explain later, that theoretical physics and mathematics is very much related, so it's not that much different. So about the personalities here, we see that mathematicians are not often not like normal people. So we know that John Nash, he was suffering from schizophrenia, as the movie explained. And Alan Turing was, oops, it's not working anymore. Okay, so Alan Turing, it's no problem. Ah, no, it's. Yeah, just to point, yeah, okay. Okay, so Alan Turing was, maybe we could say he was one of these nerds. He was not very good in communication skills and so. And Stephen Hawking, on the other hand, he was a really cool guy. He had like a lot of fun and was partying until like he had this heavy disease that binded him to the role chair. Okay. So in the first real part of the talk, I would like to explain a bit what modern mathematics is about. And I start with some very sort of personal hypothesis about modern mathematics. So maybe I should mention first that mathematics at universities, so mathematics as a science, is very different from mathematics in school. So mathematics in school is sort of often at least, I mean, depending on the teacher maybe, very often like learning rules and recipes that you then can apply to a sort of certain problems posed. In mathematics and science, we try to look like more behind these rules, and we try to understand why these rules exist, why other rules do not exist, and how such rules can be improved over time. So also my personal opinion, doing mathematics is fun and intellectually challenging at the same time, which is sort of rare, I would say, that these things coincide so closely. That mathematics is fun is difficult to explain. Mathematics has a lot to do with beauty and creativity, but it's not sort of easy to see that from outside. So one has to study it a lot, and then after some years, one can sort of understand what mathematicians mean when they talk about this fun and this beauty. It's very hard to explain this in 1 hour talk. So maybe we won't see that too explicitly today. So another thing that's plain to see is that mathematics is extremely international. So one could say universal. So all civilizations have the same, doing the same mathematics. So one can even speculate what kind of mathematics aliens would do if we'd ever meet aliens. But we can be sure that we could communicate with them about mathematics, because mathematics starts with counting things. As soon as a species is able to count things, they have numbers. If they have numbers, they can ask which numbers are divisible by other numbers. Then they have prime numbers. And prime numbers is already extremely complicated, and mathematicians are doing research about prime numbers from like the early Greeks until now. And we can be sure that any like civilized species which can count, will also have thought about prime numbers. And that's good. I mean, if we meet aliens at some point, we have something common to talk with them. The next point is something I was saying already. So mathematics stimulates creativity and curiosity and ambition. So curiosity is really important for mathematics, because we have to look around and we have to be interested in other things so that we like proceed our field of research. And the last thing that will also be like in the last part of this talk, I would like to explain that having a degree in mathematics, so studying it and completing it, that offers you like very good job opportunities worldwide. So that's something I will explain later. Okay. So I wanted to explain what mathematics is. So there is a Wikipedia definition about mathematics. So it says mathematicians seek out patterns and use them to formulate new conjectures. Mathematicians resolve the truth or falsity of conjectures by mathematical proof. And when mathematical structures are good models of real phenomena, then mathematical reasoning can provide insight or predictions about nature. Okay, this sounds indeed a bit technical and maybe nerdy. Because it sort of doesn't say, I mean, it's technically a good definition, I would say, but it doesn't sort of convey the idea how mathematicians do this, and that in order to formulate new conjectures and in order to resolve the truth or falsity of these new conjectures, mathematicians need this like curiosity and creativity to create new things, and they also need the ambition and the stamina to conduct these proofs that often like go over several years, and we have very long-term projects that are very challenging. All right. So this is one of the questions I hear very often when I am telling people that I'm a mathematician. Then they would ask, isn't everything known yet about mathematics? Which in a sense is a reasonable question, because mathematics is done for 3,000 years, maybe, or maybe even more. And it, of course, it could be that everything is known yet. But the answer is no. And the point is simply that, as for all sciences, it's true that the more you know, the more questions you can ask about it. And this is true for mathematics as well. So as supporting this a bit, I was collecting a couple of things. So there is this public preprint server. So mathematicians and physicists were like the first, I think, first scientific community who used the internet to actively distribute research results. So they're using this from the late 80s already. And today this public preprint server, so everybody can look there, this address, and can look, for example, my publication there. And they have like approximately 100,000 articles in mathematics per year. So there is a lot of research going on still. Then we also have like for almost 10 years already this online community, Mass Overflow. It's one of these stack exchange things. I'm sure you know them from other things too. And they have like approximately 10,000 active users and many questions, new questions every day. So this is only for research mathematics. There's also a Stack Exchange for school mathematics where people can pose homework problems. But if you pose a homework problem there, then the question will be closed soon. So this is only for really research, and I have like posed several questions there and have received nice answers from other mathematicians worldwide that I would not have had a chance to ask them. Yeah, then there are also some prizes for mathematicians. So there is the Abel Prize. It's also called the Nobel Prize for Mathematics. You know that there was the rumor, I mean, there is no Nobel Prize for Mathematics, and there was the rumor was that that Nobel's wife had a love affair with a mathematician, and due to that reason, he was not spending money for mathematics. There is no evidence that this is true, and so in the end, it's probably so that mathematics was simply not interesting enough for Nobel. He was an engineer, at least, so maybe he didn't have the good relation to mathematics. So then there is the Fields Medal. The Fields Medal is maybe the most prestigious prize for mathematicians. We'll come to this later. And there are also the seven millennium problems. I will also explain this now. So let's first look at the Fields Medal, because this is like the most important prize for mathematicians. It's awarded every 4 years to 2 to 4 mathematicians. So it's roughly one medal a year in average. And this Fields Medal has the particular characteristic that only persons below age of 40 are eligible. So if you are over 40 and make a big contribution to math, then that's bad luck. And actually this happened, for example, to Andrew Wiles, who proved in the late 90s the Fermat's last theorem. This was also quite popular. There was also a book about this, like a story that you can read. And when this was very, so he had really bad luck. When he published the proof, he was below 40, but then there was a mistake in the proof, and correcting this mistake took another 5 years, and then he was over 40. So he did not get a Fields Medal, unfortunately. Yeah, most of the Fields Medal go to the US, UK, and France. They spend most money for mathematicians and universities, okay. So Germany got one medal so far. So Gerd Falting, it's one on the picture, received a Fields Medal in 1986 for contribution in number theory. 2014 have been the last Fields Medals. There was the first medal for Latin America to Brazil, and also the first medal for a woman, which is sort of embarrassing for mathematics, but at least they started now giving Fields Medals to women. To Mariam Mirzakhani, who proved something about this coloring theorem. You draw a chart with like countries, and then you wonder how many colors does one need so that at no point like two countries of the same color meet. And then one can think about conditions on how the borders have to be, and then what's the lower bound on the number of colors is. And so these Fields Medals are always like awarded at a big congress of mathematicians, the ICM, the International Congress of Mathematics. And then there are lots of talks about the newest developments and that in the end these field medals are given. So the next of these meetings is in July this year in Rio de Janeiro, and yeah, Germany is hoping for another Fields Medal, we'll see. And yeah, it's also good news that Professor Uribe Bernardo will has the honor to give an invited talk at this conference, which is like a huge thing. So you can be happy to have this. Okay. The next thing is about the millennium problems. They've been on the list. So this was in 2000, that's why they're called millennium problems. The Clay Institute, some US funding thing, so identified these seven problems, and they have a bounty of $1 million each for the problem. So if you solve one of these problems, you're really rich, but they're quite difficult, unfortunately. Otherwise, I would have tried. So far, only one of the problems has been solved. The so-called Poincaré conjecture. I did something in topology. I did not want to explain exactly what it is. It was posed in 1904 and solved like almost 100 years after, in 2002, by the Russian mathematician Perelman. He was there on the picture. So now I have to tell this story. So Perelman rejected the money. He did not take the 1 million. And he said this for reason. So he said, the main reason is my disagreement with the organized mathematical community. I don't like their decisions. I consider them unjust. So they selected him for the prize. So yeah, this is, he is somebody who wanted, obviously, he is looking for like absolute justice. And because some other people contributed to this problem, and they've not been awarded 1 million, he rejected the prize. So this is maybe one of the dreamers in mathematics. So he's dreaming about absolute justice. Yeah, the six remaining problems are still unsolved, so everybody has a chance. Among them, the Riemann hypothesis was posed in 1859, so it's a really, really old problem. Something about prime numbers. And also the P unequals NP problem. That's something, actually, it's more like in computer science. It's a problem that about a question like how fast algorithms are in doing some task. And so it's particularly relevant for cryptography and like electronic data protection in the internet, because if the answer to this problem would be that P is equal to NP, this would mean that there exists an algorithm that could like very fastly decrypt encrypted messages, where encrypt means like in the usual way of how messages are encrypted. So that would be a problem. But the guess is that it's really unequal, and this would like mean that our electronic data is well protected. Actually, there was, like last year, there was a paper by a German mathematician from Bonn University who claimed that he had solved the problem to the negative. So he claimed that he had proved the P unequal NP thing. Then it took like a couple of weeks, and then somebody found a mistake in this paper. So it's still open again. All right. Yeah, here's also some sort of technical information. So mathematics is classified into several sub-areas. There are mostly two big things, namely applied mathematics and pure mathematics, as for other sciences too. So applied mathematics is analysis and optimization, graph theory, statistics. And the pure mathematics are these classical things like algebra, geometry, topology, number theory. And there is an official classification scheme that's invented by the American Mathematical Society, and they list 63 big topics and 5,000 subtopics. So mathematics is like really a field with many, many various aspects. Okay, so let me come a bit more to the pure mathematics point. So here are first two quotations about pure mathematics. So the first is the purpose of pure mathematics and of basic science in general is not the quick harvest. It's nothing less than an attempt to bring human thought and understanding to a higher level. It's an attempt to change not just what we think about the world, but how we think about it. And the other quotation is, research in applied science leads to reforms, and research in pure science leads to revolutions. Okay, so whatever we think about this, we can certainly identify these two gentlemen as pure mathematicians. So they're very convinced of what they're doing. So concerning the last thing, there certainly exist examples where this has taken place, where these revolutions of pure science or pure mathematics have been taken place, and I will give some examples later, but of course the history also went the other way, that like by developing from application to application, important progress has been achieved. So typical for pure mathematics is the concept of abstractization. So in general, abstract is the opposite of concrete. So abstractization is a process of extracting the underlying essence of a concept, removing any dependence on real world objects. And why are we doing this? Because then it admits a clear view to the core of problems. Like when all the concrete things that are irrelevant are removed, then we can plainly see the problem. Abstractization goes hand in hand with generalization. So why is that? Yeah, because two problems, they can be embedded into totally different contexts, but after getting rid of the context, the problems can turn out to be just the same, have the same core, and solving one means solving the other two. So this is generalization. And so we can see this a bit as follows. So there is like the real world, so we call this the real world, so this thing here where we can like have engineering and devices and so. And then like below or like hidden in these technical applications, there is often like mathematics with direct applications, like some numerics or statistics or something. But then like there are new problems that arise in this, in these fields, and then mathematicians have invented abstract structure that identifies underlying rules and concepts in these applications. So then it's like one step of abstractization more. And then other mathematicians have invented theory for this abstract structure, and then they have continued and invented theory for these theories. And this is like, it goes from applied to pure math. So pure math is more like theory for theories for theories, and at the end there might be an application then. Okay, so here it looks like it goes like down. So we start with applications and then we end up with theory for theory for theories. That's often working like this. Sometimes it's also going the other way. So we come to this maybe later. So I wanted to explain a bit a particular role that's played by the interaction between pure mathematics and theoretical physics. They're forming like a branch that's sort of taking place at the intersection. It's called mathematical physics, not very creative. And this started in the early 20th century when quantum theory was born. And by looking at the terminology that physicists use, one sees that many mathematicians have worked on the quantum theory and helped physics to solve the problems. So for example, the Hilbert spaces, Dirac operators, and von Neumann algebra, so all these persons were mathematicians. On the other side, questions from theoretical physics, or from quantum physics here, so they showed mathematicians what interesting questions are. So this is like, in this pure math, this is sort of a problem and something that when we educate new scientists, we have to teach them, and at some point they have to learn it, how to find the interesting questions and how to distinguish the interesting from the uninteresting questions. And looking to physics is a good source of interesting questions, because looking at these questions and solving them has like directly applications to physics. So nowadays, or in the late 20th century, string theory, I would say, has like taken this rule of quantum theory, and string theory involved like lots of things like geometry and topology, algebra, and all applied this to physics. So that's what I'm doing in my research. I'm doing geometry and topology related to string theory. So string theory is this thing that some physicists have proposed as a model for this theory of everything, what the thing where the movie with Stephen Hawking was about. It's not clear yet if that's the right idea. That's not a problem for me. If at some point it turns out not to be the right idea, then the math we have done about this will still be correct. We have proved everything, so that's not a problem. And some people suspect already that during the next century, or the coming century, that the role of physics will be replaced by biology. So they're saying biology is a new physics. Yeah, we'll see. Right now, it's not clear yet, I would say. We have to see. Okay, so now I wanted to explain that sometimes life is different than planned, and sometimes it happens that there has been pure mathematics, so people have researched in pure mathematics without any applications, and then suddenly there was an application. So for example, this happened to Einstein's general theory of relativity. So here the point was that Riemann started in 1850s studying Riemannian geometry. And then Einstein, 60 years later, he needed some mathematical framework where he could model this concept of space and time mixed together. And then he was talking to mathematicians and they were telling him, oh, there is a theory that does this. Look at the Riemann geometry. And so Einstein looked, and then he used this, and it was great. And now we really have this like really deep and interaction between geometry and general relativity. And this is not just, I mean, maybe I don't have to convince anybody that Einstein's theory of general relativity is important. It's important for our understanding of what the universe is, but it's also important in practice because the GPS positioning system, in order to make it as accurate as it is, the corrections that coming from Einstein's theory compared to the to this Newton theory that was like from the 18th century have to be calculated. And otherwise it one could not achieve like precision below 1 meter or so. So that's actually extremely relevant, yeah. So here's also a funny quotation of Einstein. He said that since the mathematicians invaded the theory of relativity, I do not understand it myself anymore. This is certainly not correct. He understood very well what they did. But Einstein was always good for a joke. So the next thing is something about cryptography. So in this field of algebraic geometry, so people have studied these elliptic curves. So there is a picture of one since also 1850. And they're still studying it. One of the millennium problems is concerned with elliptic curves. And today, so at some point, like around 2000, there was a problem that this, maybe you've heard about this RSA cryptography that was used in the early internet to encrypt messages. But when computers became faster and faster and faster, then it turned out that this RSA is not enough to really protect messages and protect data. And then, or I mean, you have to use like huge keys of megabytes, which is not very practicable. And then people have looked for like other like frameworks of like doing basically the same thing, but not like with these numbers and primes that does the RSA. And then they found that this elliptic curve, they have like, then one can calculate with them. And these calculations are extremely complicated. I mean, not complicated to perform, but complicated to reverse. And that was good for cryptography. And nowadays, like all the important internet cryptography works with this ECC, the elliptic curve cryptography. And this was all built on the mathematics that has been found like 100 years before. And in both cases, it's sort of not clear, but one can only speculate, but it's if we just think what would have happened if these theories would not have been available at the time. Then, yeah, we can only speculate. What would Einstein have done when the theory wasn't there? Then he would have to develop it himself, but it would have taken years, and then he may not have proceeded as far as he went. So it was certainly good that these things have been there. So there are two other examples, like here algebraic topology can be applied to this topic of topological data analysis. That's what the big data companies are doing, because the data sets have become so big that the ordinary statistics and like looking at the tables doesn't work anymore. And there's also a thing about this homology series that they found out that they have something to do with these phases of matter, so states in which, like, for example, insulators can be. And this can be used to like construct like storing media, for example. And also it's suspected that one can construct a quantum computer from this. Come back to that point later. Okay, so now part two of the talk, I wanted to give an example how this abstractization works in order to make it more concrete. And so this will be actually about mathematics. So there is no talk about mathematics without mathematics. And I sort of picked this thing about constructions with compass and straight edge. So these are these tools. Yeah, I have pictures because I think that in Spanish, compass is also compasso, right? So in German, it's a totally different word. So when I first learned that the thing is called compass in English, I was confused, because a compass in German is something you use to navigate on seas. But, okay, and a straight edge is this ruler. Okay, so and you may have done this in school. So I have done it in school. Like we had to like describe constructions, what one can do with a compass and a straight edge, like draw a circle, draw a line, and then do things. Yeah, and then for example, we have learned this: using a compass and a straight edge, one can divide an arbitrary angle into two halves. So how does one do that? So here is an angle, so two lines meet at a point, and there is an angle in the middle. And now we want to divide this in two halves. So how we do that? It's not very difficult. First, draw a circle around this point where the lines meet. Then we have these two intersection points of the circles with the lines, and we draw new circles around these intersection points, going through the other intersection points, like this. Okay, and then we have the intersection points between the two new circles, and we can draw a straight line using the ruler through these points, and that's half of the angle. Okay, good. All right. So we can, using compass and straight edge, divide an angle into two halves. Of course, this is not a very practical problem. It's just an example of something. The example is that we have a very concrete thing. I mean, I hand you a compass and a straight edge, and then you can do it. This is concrete, okay? It's not relevant, but it's concrete. And now I'll try to explain how abstract structure can help here. So because we might ask the following question: if we can divide an angle into two halves, can we also divide it into three thirds? Okay. And this is in fact a very classical geometric problem that already the ancient Greeks wrote about. And they couldn't decide it. They did not found a construction for dividing an angle into three thirds. And then around 1830, so very much later, Gauss and Galois developed appropriate structure, abstract structure, and theory to solve this question. I mean, can one do it or can one not do it? And then finally, in 1837, Pierre Wanzel, he published a proof saying that it's not possible. So he proved by a mathematical proof that it's not possible to take a compass and a straight edge and to trisect an angle. So I wanted to show you a bit of this proof. So, and first of all, we invent the abstract structure that helps us to prove this. And the abstract structure we need here is called a field. So now I'm doing a bit mathematics. So this is what we teach students in first semester at some point. So we tell them what a field is. So a field is basically a set of numbers in which one can add, subtract, multiply and divide. Okay, so the Spanish word is cuerpo, for feet. So the main example is what we mathematicians call the real numbers. So they're called the real numbers because these are the numbers that occur in reality. So just some numbers, period, and some digits, arbitrary numbers. And of course we can like add, subtract, multiply, and divide. Divide, of course, not by zero, but that's not what I meant. But divide by any non-zero number, okay? Okay, so that are the real numbers. Then we can also look at the integers. So the integers are the number without digits. So 1, 2, 3, and also the negatives, negative ones. That does not form a field. Yeah, and maybe I wanted to ask the audience why that's not a field. Can somebody, maybe somebody has some. So why would the integers not be a field? Ah, oh, there is somebody shows up here. Yeah.
I think it's because sometimes when you divide two integers, you get a number that is not an integer.
Yeah, exactly. That's absolutely correct. Yes. So if I divide by Yes, for example, if we divide 1 by 2, then the result is 1/2, and 1/2 is not an integer. So one cannot divide with these numbers. So it's not a field. It's always important in math that we give examples and non-examples, so that we exactly see what the difference is. Okay, there was a solution, one cannot divide, okay. There is another example, we call that Q. I'm not sure why it's called Q, but it's historically it's called Q, it's the rational numbers. So these are exactly those numbers that can be written as an integer by another integer. And this resolves sort of the problem that we can't divide by integers, so this Q is a field. The difference between Q and the real numbers is there is still a difference. For example, it's also sometimes we learn this in school, that the square root of 2, so a number that multiplied with itself is 2, is not a rational number. And also this number pi, that's responsible for when you compute the area of a circle, it's also not a rational number, right? For pi, it's just the expression, it's 3.1424, and then you have to learn all the digits or look it up, but there is no like way of writing it as ratio between two integers. Although there is also this funny story that once there was a proposal in the US Senate, for United States Senate, to fix the value of pi to 3. Which did not pass, I think, luckily. Otherwise, I don't know what would have happened. Okay, so now it's a reasonable question. Are Q and R, so the rational and the real numbers, are these all possible fields? But the answer is no, and in fact, by far not. So what's another field? So now we do some creativity. So imagine a new number, we call that I, with the property that I times I is minus 1. So of course, no actual number would have this property, because if the number is negative, then multiplying with itself would be minus times minus would be plus, cannot be negative, and it's positive, it's also positive. So no real number has this property, so but we can just think we have a number that has this property and add it to the real numbers. So then we consider a set, so that's our mathematical notation for a set, where the elements are like a sum of an ordinary real number and a real number times this number I, and A and B can be arbitrary numbers. And then it's sort of, one can like see that one can calculate with this new field. So for example, how would I do the multiplication between two numbers? So I have now two of these things that are sums of real numbers and multiples of I, and then I just use calculate it in the usual way, then I get these terms. Now this is like a bit calculus, and then and here it's the I square, which is by this rule minus 1, so there is a minus BD, so it goes here, and the terms where there is an I are factored here, so this is the result, and it's again of the form number plus number times I. So one can perfectly multiply these numbers, and there is also a formula for the division, which is a bit more complicated, so I don't show it. Yeah, so this is the field, this field is called the field of complex numbers, and the number I is called the imaginary unit. It So one can buy these funny t-shirts where I talks to pi, and I says to pi, be rational. So recall that p is not rational, but pi replies, first you get real before I get rational. Okay, so we can in fact do a similar, slightly more complicated things to the rational numbers. We can add like a number which was not there before. And in general, one can do this with a number, and now it's called x, so x was I before. And so what one needs in order to this construction is that some power of x, so x multiplied n times with itself, so with I this was 2 times, can be written as like a sum of powers of with less exponents, right? So here it's x to the n minus 1, x to the n minus 2, goes down to all a constant. So if a number x is there with this property, then we can add this. Oh yeah, here's the remark that I was a special case of this, right? I squared is 0 times I minus 1. This was the formula before, so it fits into this more general framework. And if we have a number x with this property, then we call n the degree of the number, and consider this new field where all these expressions are allowed. Okay, and then this is a new field. This is something one has to prove, and we say that it is an extension of Q of degree n. So n is important as the degree of the exponent here in this formula. Okay, I can make an example of this. I'm not sure if that's helpful. So for example, x could be a third root of 2. So a number that multiplied 3 times with itself is 2. It's of course not an integer and also not a rational number. And it obeys this formula. So if I take it to the power of 3, then it's 0 times x squared plus 0 times x plus 2. Right? That's the formula. It's multiplied 3 times with itself, it's 2. So this is an example of this formula here. So it's eligible. And the extension here has a degree 3. So that's a degree 3 extension. Okay, now we have produced a new field, and you can imagine that you can produce hundreds of fields that way. For example, by adding all possible roots of 2. Okay. So now what has this to do with compass and straight edge? So there is a theorem. So this is theory for the abstract structure. So the theorem is that a number x, like which I have here on the line, so this is a line of numbers, 0, 1, and here is some x. So when can I construct this number x from by compass and straight edge? So I could now start like drawing circles around 0, around 1, and I can draw lines, and you can imagine that I can like construct certain points on the line and others maybe not. And the theorem is exactly saying which points can be constructed. Namely, only those points whose degree that we just defined earlier is one of these numbers here. It's a power of 2. It's 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, and in general of the kind 2 to the power of k. So that's the abstract theorem. That's a theorem that we prove in third semester, so in second year to students. So this is already a bit too complicated to make it to give the exact proof here, so I have to argue a bit why this is true. And so why is this power of 2 there? So it comes basically from the fact that with this compass and straight edge, we can draw circles and lines. So now you have learned in school by which kind of equations circles and lines are described. So lines are described by linear equations like ax plus b, but circles are described by quadratic equations like this. So here r is the radius of the circle and a and b are the coordinates. So a circle has something to do with squares, and resolving for a or for b has something to do with square roots. So this is why this 2 appears here. Okay. So whenever I have a point that is on the intersection of a circle and a line, then its coordinates are square roots of points that have been there earlier. And so we have the theorem because we make a construction, construct a new point, then we can again make a circle around this point and get another point, and each step will at most add a square root of 2. So the whole degree of the thing will then multiply. This is another statement one has to prove. And then after k steps, the degree is 2 to the k. So that's why this theorem is true. So rather than proving it more precisely, let's try to apply it. So I wanted to jump over this. So the statement that we wanted to prove is that it's not possible to divide an angle of 60 degree to divide an angle in 3/3. So if we want to prove or want to falsify this, then it suffices to prove that one particular angle is not divisible by 3. And let's take the angle of 60 degrees. And then we make the following experiment. So here is the angle of 60 degrees. And if we could trisect it into 3/3, then we could construct this line. If we can construct this line, then we can draw this circle and the straight line down to the x-axis and have this point x. And this point x has the coordinate cosine of 20 degrees. Okay, this is like the usual formula for coordinates on a circle. Okay, now in school we may have learned lots of these totally useless identities with cosines. For example, this here one. I mean, this is a complicated one, but you might have learned other ones. So this is, of course, yeah. So this is a rule for an angle alpha. And if we use 20 degrees, then cosine, here we have cosine 60, which is 1/2. So it reduces to this formula. And this formula, by dividing by 4 and doing some usual manipulations, I can make it to this equation. And this is of the form that we had earlier. So the element x to the power of 3 can be written as a multiple of x plus some constant. So x has degree 3. This point x has degree 3 and it's constructible. And this brings us to the end of the proof. We have the theorem was saying that one can only construct points of degree power of 2. 3 is not a power of 2, so x is not constructible. And if x is not constructible, this angle is not divisible into 3/3. And if one angle is not divisible into 3/3, then the general statement is false. Okay, so this was the proof that by abstract structure. So the abstract structure was this notion of a field. And then there was a theorem about this abstract structure. And then we succeeded in showing that this thing is not possible. All right. So now I'm skipping some things. Yeah, here this is also funny. There exist people who sort of simply do not believe that a mathematical proof can say that you cannot take a compass and a straight edge and do something. So there are people that sort of refuse the idea that a proof that somebody writes down prevents them to do something. And they are like sending like lots of manuscripts to mathematicians to check proof that it's possible. And there is this mathematician Dudley who collected them into 2 books you can buy at Amazon if you want. Okay, so the last part of the talk, I wanted to explain a bit what mathematicians do in the real world. So this refers to the point that I was saying that a degree in mathematics like offers nice job opportunities. And so here's first the general thing. So where do mathematicians work? So they work in insurance companies, computer technology companies, financial services, transportation and logistics. They work for the energy industry, consulting business, management. So you see, there is no actual field where they usually work. They work like everywhere. And approximately 80%, this is just like very approximately, of all the mathematicians, they don't do any math in their job. So how can that be? There is following quotation of Gauss, which is it's very nice. He's saying it's not knowledge, but the act of learning, not possession, but the act of getting there, which grants the greatest achievement. And that's exactly the point. The mathematicians are not hired because they have learned how to trisect an angle or not to do it. They are hired because they have learned how to abstractize and how to solve problems. So they are learned they're hired because they can separate important from unimportant. They know how to learn and understand new things. They have the stamina to conduct seemingly hopeless long-term projects. I can tell you that this is really true. I mean, if you work like 5 to 10 years on a project and you have so many points where you say, okay, so now I quit it, it's hopeless, and then you still go on and like in the end you succeed, hopefully. They maintain precision and correctness. I have another funny citation for precision and correctness of mathematicians. So this is what André Duhadie wrote as the first sentence of his PhD thesis. The goal of this thesis is to equip its author with the title of a doctor. Yeah, if that's not precise and correct, then I don't know. Okay. So I also found some official statistics. Maybe that's not too interesting, but there is some data that sort of supports what I'm saying. That's like the only message maybe. So the US Bureau of Labor Statistics, that's like the instance I was looking at here. They have like a statistics about annual wages for mathematicians. They're like incredibly $105,000 in average. So I should talk to my head of university, definitely. They are expecting that the employment of mathematics grows by 30% until 2026. So there are really good prospects for jobs for mathematicians. Yeah, so I can also tell you from my personal experience what people did with whom I studied in Hamburgo University. So for example, so most of them went to consulting actually. So the first year was a person who wrote a thesis in applied math, and now she is project manager at McKinsey. So the next person is associate director at Ernst & Young consulting businesses. We have people at Siemens, very interesting jobs. I have like one colleague who was sitting next to me in the office in Hamburg. He has a group of technicians. He's group leader at Siemens, and they are building these big wind parks offshore in the North Sea. So this is extremely interesting. He's going by helicopter to the windmills and looking. And he wrote a thesis about algebra and tensor categories. So it's really really abstract math. And so here's this. Last but one point, she is head of maritime techniques at EnBW. That's one of the Germany's biggest energy companies. So they're really an important job. So the same is true for people who did a postdoc. So they, after doing their PhD, they did postdocs positions and then left academia. So they also got nice jobs. Here is a colleague from Berkeley who is now analyst at Google, which is certainly a great job. Then another person here. He went to the Citibank. He is actually from Chile, and I met him in Berkeley. Then there is a data scientist at a company that does this topological data analysis, so he might be doing really math, I'm not sure. Also, some mathematicians have been good in politics, so our German Minister of Education and Science was a professor of mathematics, and also our chancellor, Angela Merkel. Okay, that's a bit cheating. She's not a mathematician, but a theoretical physicist, which is not far away from that. So, also, that's another interesting thing. So Microsoft has a research station, Q is that called, that's in Santa Barbara. The Q stands for quantum, and the goal of that research station is to build a quantum computer. And as director, they appointed Michael Friedman. He's a topologist, and he won a Fields Medal in 1986 for proving a four-dimensional version of this Poincaré conjecture, where this Russian Perelman proved the general thing. And then there is the last thing. Then I'll stop. Is extreme example of James Simons. So James Simons wrote a PhD in Berkeley in geometry and topology. Then he was a code breaker in Vietnam Wars. Then he got professor at New York. Then he wrote an extremely famous paper with the mathematician Chern. It's like one of the most important papers of this century, I guess. And this Chern-Simons theory was invented, so now it's a big topic. And then he left academia. He entered financial industry. He founded this investment firm, Renaissance Technologies. You can look for this. He earned a lot of money with that, and he founded the Simon Center for Geometry and Physics. It's like a huge university institute in Long Island. 2016, he earned $1.5 billion in 1 year by his investment company. And last year, he was ranked 49 in the Forbes list of richest person in the world. And the joke is that, I mean, he really used mathematics and his mathematical knowledge to lead this investment firm. And he had algorithms, at least that's what they're saying. I have met him, but I haven't talked to him. Okay, so in conclusion, some mathematicians are a bit nerdy or otherworldly. Some mathematicians became very rich or important, but the vast majority of mathematicians works in absolutely normal and decent jobs in science, industry, and consulting. Yeah, thank you very much for listening.
Muchas gracias por venir a esta conferencia y como muestra del aprecio que tenemos a Conrad por haber venido a visitarnos, se le entrega por medio de la Cátedra Europa un reconocimiento de una artesanía que está hecha en el pueblo de Sacurí, donde el profesor aquí es originario. Muchísimas gracias, Conrad, por haber venido.
21ª Cátedra Europa, el encuentro académico y cultural del Caribe colombiano y el mundo académico europeo. Europa se vive en el Caribe.